Let's continue on listening to God's word.
Build his temple and build his people.
We're currently in the midst of our series, Building His Temple, Building His People. Today we'd like to look at a passage found in Ezra chapter 5, verses 1 to chapter 6, verse
15. The
topic, our sermon title is very exciting. It's called Finish. It's the conclusion of the whole construction process for the temple. Chapter 1 tells about God moving the heart of King Cyrus to allow the people to rebuild his temple. There were 49,000 plus people who responded to this calling. And they went back to Jerusalem. And there they would like to reconstruct and rebuild the temple of the Lord. So after they laid the foundation for the temple, the enemy's persecution started to come.
The last message,
the enemies used four kinds of different methods to oppose God's word. The first is to compromise. They are tempting the people to compromise. But the Jewish people refused. The second method is to disrupt them. It's there to discourage the people. But the people of Israel, they just chose to ignore. The third method, they used money to bribe people to persecute the people of Israel. But it was not effective. So they used the fourth method. It's to falsely accuse the people of Israel. And this one seemed to work. Because the construction work for the temple was stopped. You know how long it was stopped? And it was stopped for 16 years.
Ezra chapter 4 and chapter 5,
so in between chapter 4 and chapter 5 of Ezra, there was a 16-year period. For 16 years, the work ceased.
Why?
Because the people of Israel were discouraged. During the start, they had this desire, they had this excitement to start working for the Lord. But because of the persecution, because of the opposition of people, it seems like it's like they were doused with cold water, and all the excitement, all the heat from the body just dissipated. So for 16 years the word stopped, the people of Israel stopped working on the temple of the Lord. So what did they do? Instead, they went back to their own homes and they started building their own homes. There's nothing wrong about building your house.
Because
all of us have our houses that we need to take care of. But for 16 years, if you're just paying attention to your own house and you're not doing things for the Lord, there's something wrong. Where is the problem? The problem is here.
Priorities.
It's our priorities. They lost their priorities. Jesus said, but seek ye first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. The Lord Jesus has given us this very important principle. What is more important?
What makes it put first in your life?
What do we need to put first in our lives?
Put God first in your life.
We need to put God first in our lives.
Keep the main thing, the main thing, the main thing.
And we need to keep the main thing as the main thing. Or else we will be going in the wrong path. In the 16 years period, they only did work in their own houses.
And
they completely ignored the work of the Lord.
Something wrong.
There's something wrong.
Seek ye the first of kingdom of God.
We need to seek first the kingdom of the Lord.
Everything shall be added unto you.
And everything will be given to us. This is the promise of the Lord Jesus Christ. And this is the truth. I've been serving the Lord for 28 years. This word. Not only did I just read this word,
personal experience.
But these words are my personal experience in my service here in the Philippines. And I dare not speak more about it. Because I fear that you might misunderstand. You might think that I'm here working for material things.
But this is the truth.
But this is the truth. In the 28 years I've been serving here, God has given me beyond what I can imagine. Just imagine, in this 28 years, not accounting the time I spent here at CBCP, the Lord has provided two new cars for me through the kindness of people. And there's something that's more than the value of the cars. The Lord will not give, will not allow the people serving the Lord to lack anything. And the people of Israel forgot one thing. They only minded their own house and they forgot and they ignored the Lord's house. They lost their priorities. In 16 years, they only look at their own work and they completely ignored the work of the Lord. What was the result? The work to be done at the Lord's temple was stopped. And the people of Israel did not receive blessings from the Lord. You remember what the book of Haggai tells us. Haggai said something that's very important.
Pastor Mike gave this message.
You remember Pastor Mike preached this message. You've planted much but harvested little. You eat but never have enough. You drink but never have your fill. You put on cloths. You have planted much but harvested little. You eat but never have enough. You drink. Because the Lord has not blessed them. They did their own work. And the Lord did not take care of them. May the Lord help us. If you only depend on yourself, the Lord will say, go ahead, do your own thing. You will receive just enough. Psalm 23.
My cup overflows.
David said, my cup overflows. My cup overfloweth. That's the description of somebody who is following the Lord, who is doing the Lord's work. The people of Israel lost the blessing of the Lord because they refused to walk down the path of the Lord. They only look at their own things and minded their own things and not those things for the Lord. After 16 years, why did they start rebuilding the temple again? There were two very important reasons. It's all because of God's work and God's grace. If you are to look at verses 4 and 5, you can see that through the work of the Lord, through the grace of the Lord, they were able to rebuild the temple. You look at God's word. Look at chapter 5, verse 1. Now Haggai the prophet and Zechariah the prophet, a descendant of Edo, prophesied to the Jews in Judah and Jerusalem in the name of God of Israel, who was over them. God has raised up two very important characters, the prophet Haggai and the prophet Zechariah. And they were the ones that were preaching to the people of Israel to challenge them, to encourage them, and to discipline them. Look at verse 2. Then Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, and Joshua, the son of Jozadak, set to work to rebuild the house of God in Jerusalem, and the prophets of God were with them, supporting them. Look at the English Bible.
The prophets of God were there supporting them. Supporting them to continue using the word of God to supporting them, to challenge them, to encourage them.
This, we look at the last phrase, the prophets of God were with them, supporting them. The word supporting them means they continually use God's word to challenge, to support, encourage, and rebuke these people. The word of the Lord. It's the power behind the things that we do. The work for the temple ceased for 16 years. And it's something that cannot be restarted again. Just for 16 years, we've been so used to our routine. Why did they want to rebuild the temple? Because God's word moved them. 16 years ago, these 49,000 people, they were very fervent for the Lord. Right now, they were very cold towards the Lord. So they put down the work of the Lord. Instead, they mind their own work, they rebuild their own houses. So the prophet told them, what did the prophet say? Is it the time for you yourselves to be living in your paneled houses while this house remains a ruin? Look at verse 9. Because of my house which remains a ruin, which each of you is busy with your own house. This is what the Lord Almighty declares. When you are cold in your heart, every Sunday they'll come here to worship the Lord. But their heart is not truly for the Lord. Instead, their heart is there, focusing on their own work, their own business, their own money. Remember the story of David? When David was the king, he was living inside the king's palace. Suddenly he said, I am living within the palace. Where is my God? My God is residing in a tent. That inside the tabernacle. This is something that should not be.
Imagine.
You're living within your mansion. Your parents. And your parents are living in the squatter area. How can you continue living like that? If you love your parents, and it's something you will not allow to happen. That's why David said, it's impossible. I would like to build a temple for the Lord. Even though the Lord did not allow David to build temple. But the Lord honored his desire. The people of Israel, in 16 years, they completely forgot about the work of the Lord. Instead, they just focused on their own affairs. And the Lord raised up two prophets, Zechariah and Prophet Haggai, to prophesy to them, to preach to them. If you want to know more, what kind of message?
The book of Zechariah.
Go home and read the book of Zechariah. There are 14 chapters there. And read the book of Haggai. There are only two chapters. Look at these 16 chapters. And how the Lord used his own prophets to rebuke, to encourage, and to challenge these people. I'd like to give you something more important. In book of Ezra, chapter 24, the work on the temple in Jerusalem stopped until the second year of Darius's reign.
Chapter 6:15.
In the the sixth year of the king Darius's reign, the work of the temple was completed.
There's
only 3.5 years in between. So within 3.5 years, they were able to construct the temple. In this 3.5 years. And this is a story that you can find in the 16 chapters between the book of Haggai and the book of Zechariah.
In
this 3.5 years, the Lord did not stop talking to the people of Israel. God's word
is
life. God's word
is
a word that can transform our lives. As we listen and observe God's word, your life will be transformed. Your value system will be changed. And you'll find yourself completely different. We are currently starting our church building. Even though we have not completed our fundraising, but we have already opened our fundraising in the past month. And there are people who responded to the Lord's word because they were moved by God's word. And people have started giving to the fund that we needed for this
construction.
Recently, I received an offering.
$2.5 million.
This is not a small amount of money. In fact, this is a big amount of money. And in that offering, there was a letter. And it was specified there not to let anybody know who was the one who donated that amount. Of course, I will not let you know who the person is. But I would like to share with you a portion of that message found in the offering. Why he gave, that person gave $2.5 million to the church. This is his message.
In this journey we call life, God's word is a lamp unto my feet and a light on my path. We are the members of CBCB are truly blessed to have a down-to-earth pastor who effectively plants God's word in our heart, inspiring and motivating us to emulate God's virtue in thought, in word, and in deed.
God's word, when it's planted in your heart, it'll transform your lives. It'll transform the way you speak. It'll transform your actions. Jesus said, where your money is, or where your treasure is, that's where your heart will be also. Unless the Lord change your values, then you cannot give that amount of money. May the Lord help us. Because only God's word can change the way you think. I'd like to show you a passage in the Bible. And it can be found in Proverbs 24:3-4. By wisdom a house is built, and through understanding it is established. Through knowledge its rooms are filled with rare and beautiful treasures.
A house is built. A house, not a building.
When we speak about the house here, it doesn't refer to the physical building.
It's
about our family. The people within that family. And Solomon's here teaching us how to establish a family. In this passage, there are three very important words. Wisdom. Understanding. And knowledge. What is wisdom?
Is information.
It means information. What is understanding?
It's comprehension.
To comprehend. What is wisdom?
Is application.
It means application. We always start with the knowledge.
So, when I say The power, the knowledge is the power.
We often say knowledge is power. It's very important for us to have information. But what is true knowledge? What is the Bible tells
fear
us?
Fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge.
The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. The true knowledge comes from the fear of the Lord. Because true knowledge can be only be found in the Bible. Inside this Bible is the word of the Lord. This Bible is the truth that will never change. If you want true knowledge,
you go back to the Bible.
You go back to the Bible.
And
to know about the truth and to know true knowledge.
So
knowledge comes from the Lord's word. Look at what the Bible tells us. The prophet Amos said something very important. Declares a sovereign Lord, not a famine for food or a thirst for water, but a famine of hearing and the words of the Lord. This is what we call spiritual famine. This kind of church. They, during the praise and worship time of
their,
they can go on for 1 hour. But during the preaching, they tell the pastor,
not more than 15 minutes.
Not more than 15 minutes. Because the people will get sleepy. I'm telling you, that kind of church is a church that will be experiencing spiritual famine. They will not be standing and nor will they be established in the word of the Lord.
Hallelujah, praise the Lord.
They want to just hallelujah, praise the Lord. But when the problem comes, they will depart from the Lord because they are not firmly rooted in the word of the Lord. Psalm 1. The righteous is like a tree planted by the stream of water. The stream of water is like the word of God. We should be firmly rooted there. So when the drought comes, we will not be afraid because we are beside the stream of water. May the Lord help us. We need to go back and study the word of God. And the church should be speaking about the word of God. And as children of God, you need to go home and study the word of
Listen,
God.
Listen, you are not just read the Bible, you need to study the Bible.
We don't just read the Bible, we need to study the Bible. What is the difference?
Read the Bible.
If you just read the Bible,
but not enough,
it's not never
you
enough.
You study your own Bible.
You need to study your own Bible.
Read the Bible and study the Bible.
You read and you study. There's only one thing that's different between the two. You need a ball pen.
Read the Bible.
You read the Bible. You don't need the ball pen.
Study
to read
your Bible.
When you study the Bible, you need a ball pen.
Write down.
To write down things.
Your insight.
You write down your insight.
Write down.
Write down God's word. If you do that every day, after 3 years, you'll find that your comprehension of the Bible is completely different.
So listen. Don't just read the Bible, but study your Bible.
Don't just read the Bible. You study the Bible.
Study just one verse.
Use
it's 15 enough.
Minutes every day. That's enough already for you to study the Bible. For you to go deeper and to know more about the word of God. Your life will be different. But just to have this knowledge or information is never enough.
That's your understanding.
We need understanding.
Understanding is a comprehension.
Means we need to comprehend. Many times, we study, we don't understand. Because we don't comprehend. We need to comprehend. And to truly comprehend. You know, in the Philippines, most of us, the Chinese children, have gone through Chinese school. Majority of us who study Chinese were just there by rote memory, studying by rote memory. And we continue to just memorize and to write. So during the test or quizzes, we do good. Probably we cheated. We probably have 98 or 99 or even 100. But after graduating, and we return it back to the teacher.
Teacher, thank you.
We say, teacher, thank you. I'm returning this to you. Because we truly do not comprehend the things that we were studying when we were in Chinese class. Probably you don't believe me. You know, to study Chinese is one of the more important things that you can acquire in this life. And the Chinese translation of the Bible is one of the best translations that can be found.
Let me tell you.
This Bible is called this version. It was written by 70 scholars from England.
Imagine, oh.
Just imagine. The original text was not written by Chinese. But rather, there are 70 scholars from England who wrote this. These 70 scholars,
Bible scholar.
These were all Bible scholars. They are experts in Hebrew. And they wrote this version of the Bible in Chinese. After they concluded their work, there's only one person that's alive, remaining alive. The 69 other experts already passed away. This Bible, this is the most accurate translation according to the original text. It's sad to say. Because we study Chinese by rote memory, we don't understand anymore. Because we don't comprehend. There was a father, when he speak, he often would add this phrase, go and eat. But before he will say that, he would often say, 3721.
So
go and eat. If he asks you to do things, don't think about it, 3721. Just go and do it. So this child often would hear his parents or his father say, 3721. One day, the child had a quiz. He had a math quiz. So there was a test question there. 3 times 7. So when he got home, and his father asked him, do you know how to answer a quiz? 3 times 7. And the son answered, 3721. I don't know the answer, so I put in 11. That child, it seems like he knew, but he never comprehended. Many times, we are, as Christians, we are just like that. It seems like we know so much about the truth in the Bible. Jesus is our Savior. He died on the cross. And He's the way, the truth, and the life. If you believe in Jesus, accept Jesus, you will have eternal life. And we put it in a very simple term. But how many of us truly comprehend? Not only do we need the knowledge,
but
we need to understand.
The true comprehension.
And we need to comprehend. As we understand, as we comprehend,
one more.
We need one more.
We need wisdom.
We need wisdom.
Wisdom in application.
To be able to apply the things that we know. Everything is just head knowledge.
Even though this is I comprehend.
And even though you truly comprehend, but if you don't apply, your life will never be changed.
So Reverend Edmund Chan,
that's why Reverend Edmund Chan always say, the truth of the word of God will never change you unless you apply the truth you
learn.
Unless you apply God's truth in your life,
nothing will change.
Nothing will change. 16 years, the people of Israel just completely stopped doing God's word,
that
they went after their own affairs. But God raised up two prophets, the prophet Haggai and the prophet Zechariah, and he used God's word to challenge them, to move them, to rebuke them. So what was the result? Look at verse 2 of chapter 5. So they rebuilt the house of the God, of God in Jerusalem. They start to rebuild it again. They put it into action. May the Lord help us. The things that we know in our heads, we know a lot of things. But if we don't move, if we don't act it out, it'll never transform or change anything. God's word. It was the first reason why the people of Israel were moved to start the work of the Lord again.
Number two,
it's God's grace. In these two chapters, it's full of God's grace. But the Bible used one sentence to describe everything. What was the sentence? God's eyes were upon the people, were watching on the people. Chapter 5, verse 5. But the eyes of their God was watching over the elders of the Jews, and they were not stopped until a report could go to Darius and his written reply be received.
The eyes of their God was watching over them.
The eyes of their God was watching over them.
So
that's why the work of the temple net was not stopped. It continued on. Not only that, when the reply of the king came, look at verse 7. Do not interfere with the work of this temple of God. Let the governor of the Jews and the Jewish elders rebuild this house of God on its site. The first command, do not interfere with the work of this temple of God. To allow them to continue to establish God's kingdom, not God's temple. Not only that, look at verse 8. Merely I have hereby decreed what you are to do to these elders of the Jews in the construction of this house of God. Their expenses are to be fully paid out of the royal treasury from the revenues of the Trans-Euphrates, from the revenues of Trans-Euphrates, so that the work will not stop. All the revenues, all the funds that they will be needing will be fully paid by the king. You do not interfere with the work.
Number two,
all the fundings that are needed will be supplied. But that's not yet over. Look at verse 9. Whatever is needed, young bulls, rams, male lambs for the burnt offerings to the God of heaven, and wheat, salt, wine, and olive oil are requested by the priests in Jerusalem, must be given to them daily without fail.
Given them daily without fail.
You have to give them their daily needs without fail. If they need bowls, need lamb, wheat, salt, wine, in material things, support them. But that's not yet. But there's more. Look at verse 11. Furthermore, I decree that if anyone defies this edict, a beam is to be pulled from their houses and they are to be impaled on it. And for this crime, their house is to be made a pile of rubble. Verse 12, may God who has caused his name to dwell there overthrow any king or people who lifts a hand to change this decree or to destroy this temple in Jerusalem. I, Darius, have decreed it. Let it be carried out with diligence. Nobody can change this edict. Whoever tries to change it, his houses will be destroyed. There are three things that we can find there.
Number one, it forbid
the obstruction of the work.
Number two,
to provide the construction needs.
Number three,
to forbid the alteration of the decree. These three things. The Bible used one word.
The eyes of God watching over them.
Can be summed up in one phrase. The eyes of the Lord of God God was watching over them. If you to look at chapter 5 and 6, it looks like it's very long. It's very simple. I'll give you the structure. Chapter 5, verses 1 to 5
is
God's message to the two prophets to deliver the message of God to them. In verse 6, from chapter 5, verse 6 to chapter 6, verse 12, there are two letters. And chapter 6, verses 13 to 15, the work of the temple is completed. The most important thing is that the middle part. Between the time that God gave his message and the completion of the work of the temple, there were two letters. What are these two letters? The first letter is an opposition letter. The enemies were opposing the work. They wrote letters to tell the king. They're starting the temple. How can we stop them? The second letter is a consent letter. And the king said, do not oppose them.
Let go.
Let them do it. You know what's the reason? Because one night, because the king in his palace, he found a letter. What was that letter? It was Ezra chapter 1, 1 to 4, that letter. And from the letter, he found out that the previous king, King Cyrus, had made a decree to ask the people of Israel to rebuild the temple of the Lord. Since that is the case,
so he
gave out a decree saying that you cannot oppose the work. The Bible used one sentence.
The eyes of God watching over them.
The eyes of God watching over them. What does it mean to have the eyes of the Lord upon you? It means the protection of the Lord and the blessing of the Lord. You know, as parents, I'm sure you have this experience. When our children were still small, we bring our children to McDonald's or to Jollibee to eat, and the children will be very happy. Today, if you bring them to McDonald's, say no. They want to go to time zone because they want to have the computer games. It's different from our time. During the past, our children, we bring them to McDonald's. If you bring them to McDonald's or Jollibee, they'll be so happy.
You know why?
You know why?
Number one,
they have food to eat.
Number two,
they can play. Just during that time, all the McDonald's have this playground for kids. So as the parents were eating, the children were playing. You know, when me and my wife, when we were bringing our three kids to McDonald's, after eating, they would play. And we would just converse. Do you know our eyes never left our children. One of my eyes was focused on my wife and the other eye was focusing on my kids. So whatever happens, I know immediately.
Eyes watching over them.
That's what we mean when we say eyes watching over them. That's how parents are. What more, our Heavenly Father? Dear Christians, the Lord is protecting us. That is the blessing of the Lord. Let me continue on. As Christians, don't use the word lucky. Don't get into the habit of using the word lucky.
Or we say suerte.
We don't use the word suerte. And we will say, it's really very suerte.
Yes, I know.
But remember, that's the blessing of God. Because there's no such thing, there's no such word as coincidence in the Bible. It's all being arranged by God. It is a blessing from the Lord. You know, the most recent experience that I have, I probably have mentioned this. It's my house catching fire. The building that I'm residing in, I'm living on the 12th floor. One night, the 5th floor caught fire. So we have this visiting pastor from the United States. So we were, after a meeting, we had a meal together.
On the way to
home, on my way home, my phone rang. My wife called me. She told me that her building was on fire. That time, my wife was in church. They were in HV. She was singing in HV, rehearsing. I was outside in the meeting. And she told me that the building was on fire. And I said to my wife, call the kids, ask them to go down from the building. What should we do? We don't know what to do anymore. We can't do anything anymore. So we just prayed. We just lift everything up to the Lord. 15 minutes. A co-worker here called me. You know that your building was on fire? Because that person was a fire volunteer. Don't fear, because I'm here.
Oh, thank you.
Okay, I said thank you.
For 5 minutes.
5 minutes later, he called me up. Fire's in control.
Oh, okay,
and I said thank the Lord. When I got home, I saw two fire trucks parked outside my building. So I went in. There's no fire anymore.
And
I realized one thing. How come it was quickly extinguished? Because before the fire could spread, there were at least two people there that started the firefighting work. And these two people were members of our church. They don't live in that building, but they have relatives that live there. That night they went there to eat lumpia. So it's good for us to be eating lumpia. But you know, they shouldn't be there on that day. It was few days ago that they should have been there, but because of previous
commitments,
it was delayed. And it was only that night
that
both of them went there to eat lumpia. Suddenly they saw the smoke, so these two brothers went down and they started to fight the fire. So when the fire trucks arrived, the fire was in control and almost extinguished. And you say to them, and I could say it's very suerte.
No.
But it's not. I know it was the help of people. But it is the blessing of God. Sometimes we often would like to use this phrase. What kind of sentence? We have an angel. We have a guardian angel. A guardian angel was there.
I know.
We know there are people that are truly kind-hearted. They like to help people. But remember, it is the blessing of the Lord. It is the move, the touching of the Holy Spirit. I'd like to share with you a testimony. When I was in Grace as a pastor there, Sunday afternoon, after preaching, I went home to rest. I had this touching and conviction. This conviction in my heart to visit somebody. Because I knew that this brother was in the hospital the previous week. He had a surgery. But I was unable to visit him. But that afternoon, I had this conviction to visit him. You know, I'm very tired in the afternoon.
I followed the leading of the Spirit.
But I followed the leading of the Spirit. So I visited the person. And as I opened the door, It seems like he had prepared everything and he was about to leave. He had already packed all the things. And said, Pastor, you're here. I'm about to leave. I said, okay, you're about to leave. What are you waiting for? I have nobody that, who can take me home.
No problem.
I said, no problem. I'll bring you home. You know what he said?
Pastor.
He said, Pastor,
this is just another T-side.
You are a guardian angel.
So, you know,
from that day on, and every time we meet in church, you know what he called me? He called me Reverend Cheung the angel. Reverend Cheung the angel. I'm not going to be human, I'm going to be an angel. Sometimes the Lord will convict us to help somebody. So for that person, you're the guardian angel. But it's truly the conviction of the Lord. The Bible often tells us this. There's this person called Joseph. This person is very famous. Wherever he would be there, people loved him. The Bible always tells this. He often found favor in the eyes. And every time when this phrase appears, there would be a following phrase. Because the Lord was with him.
The Lord was with him.
Because the Lord was with him.
He found favor in the eyes of people.
He found favor in the eyes of people. He was there at his master's house. He was a slave. But the master saw that the Lord was with him.
So he found favor in the master.
That's why he found favor with his master. When he was in prison,
the same
thing happened. The Lord was with him. And he was granted favor in the eyes of the prison warden. Not only was this for Joseph, another person called Daniel, the same way. In the eyes of the head eunuch, he found favor. The Bible often would mention this. When people help you, because you have found favor in that person. Because God's blessing, God's presence was with you. You know, as I started as a pastor, as I was reading the book of Genesis, I looked at the life of Joseph. I have this prayer. So I said, Lord, wherever you will bring me,
favor in the eyes of people.
May I find favor in the eyes of people. Please be with me. This is often my prayer. And I realize that God is so faithful to me. I've been to many different places.
I really, really found the favor of the eyes of people.
I've always been found favorable in the eyes of these people. Sometimes I cannot believe it myself. People have been so kind to me. And I feel that I'm unworthy of their kindness. I'd like to share with you this testimony. 1988, when I came to the Philippines, it was the first time for me to attend an engagement, a Chinese engagement ceremony. I was surprised. They placed so many things on the table. In front was all the jewelries, gold, necklaces, rings, watches, and behind them were so many other things. In Hong Kong, we don't have engagement parties. So I asked my pastor, what are these things? These are gifts given during engagement. I said, so much. And she said, no, these are only little. These are quite ordinary. There are people who are even more extravagant than this. I had this feeling, this thought in my heart. I will not get engaged. I will not get engaged. Because I don't have the capacity to buy all these things. How can I get engaged? You know, when I came to the Philippines, how much my salary was? 3,000 pesos per month. 3,000 pesos per month. And I was asking myself, how can I get engaged? How can I get married?
God is so faithful to me.
But God is so faithful to me. When I met my wife, and her parents knew I was a pastor. And my mother-in-law is so kind to me. Before I pursued my wife, I first had to be friends with my future mother-in-law. And she was so kind to me. So every time I go to their house, she would cook for me. If my wife did not call me, my mother-in-law would ask her to call me. You're a pastor, no need for gifts. And I said, that cannot be. You are to be married. The whole person will be yours forever. And you're not going to bring out anything. I said, even if I go bankrupt, I'm going to give out some things. Suddenly, this person gave me an amount of money. It's not, that person was not from the church, from my church.
完全,
and I don't know that person. And that person only heard me speak once. And gave me this amount of money. You know how much? That's 100,000. You know how much the value of 100,000 during that time was? Can you imagine? My salary is only 3,000. You know how many months worth of salary that 100,000 pesos was?
Found the favor of the eyes of people.
I found favor in the eyes of people. So I used
that
100,000 to buy things, to buy the dowry.
Buy.
And to prepare the dowry for the engagement. So God's blessing will be upon us and we will never lack anything. The work of the Lord was stopped for 16 years. Because God's word reestablished them. And during that process, there were difficulties. But God's grace was there to sustain them. So after 3.5 years, the work on the Lord's temple was completed. May the Lord help us. This famous person called Hudson Taylor. He was the founder of what was formerly known as the Inland China Mission. Right now we know it as OMF.
Inland China,
because he was the very first missionary to go to bring people into inland China. Because there was no missionary that dare to go inland China. Most of them would just reside on the fringes, on the port areas. He was the first missionary to bring so many missionaries into inland China. And he had done so many great things for the Lord there. In his old age, somebody interviewed him.
Mr. Hudson Taylor.
He said, Reverend Taylor, you have done so much for the Lord. What is your secret? And he said something that's very interesting. And he said, I realized that I found out that God's work have three stages.
靠这个 stage,
the first stage,
impossible.
It's called impossible.
用上帝的工作开始都是 impossible.
Whenever you see God's work, it seems like it's impossible to achieve. It's something that it's not achievable. How can be me as a one person go inland?
Impossible.
It's impossible.
In the beginning, those are impossible.
Many times when you see God's work at the beginning, it's seemingly impossible. If it's possible, then it's your work.
Impossible.
But since it's impossible, it's the work of the Lord that to be done by you.
Groundbreaking, no?
We're about to do the groundbreaking.
Construction, no?
We're about to start construction. You know, this property is
impossible.
This is an impossible thing. You know how much this was worth? You know,
per square meter is 89,000 per square meter.
It's per square meter is about 80 to 100,000 per square meter.
Imagine,
just imagine
per square meter.
Per square meter.
80 to 100,000 per square meter.
80 to 100,000 per square meter.
That's 3,100 square meter.
And we have about 3,100 square meters. So do the math.
It's impossible for us.
It's impossible for us.
And Shongde doing something miracles.
But God performed his miracle.
Impossible became possible.
What was impossible became possible.
Impossible.
But because in the beginning it was impossible. If by faith you continue on doing God's work, in this process,
you would
find another stage.
Very, very difficult.
What was impossible become very, very difficult. God's work. It's never easy.
Difficult.
It's very difficult.
我相信,
I believe that when we start construction in these 2 years, we will face a lot of problems.
Very difficult.
Because this task is very difficult. Because the things that we need, the resources that we need,
very
is big.
Difficult.
It's very difficult.
Hold on.
But we hold on.
Trusting God.
We trust the Lord. And we will reach the third stage.
Finished.
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 It's finished.
了了.
It's done.
这是哈森泰勒一共三个 stage.
These are the three stages according to Reverend Hudson Taylor.
你有相信不?
Do you believe so?
求上帝帮助我们.
May the Lord help us.
那个上帝是不会改变的上帝.
Our Lord is an unchanging God.
过去跟现在都是相反.
He's what he was in the past, he will be in the future, today and in the future.
求主帮助我们.
May the Lord help us.
Trusting our God.
Trusting our God.
问过的.
I often tell my co-workers here in church, as we establish this new church, not only do I want this new church building to be built, I want in the process of building this church building, all of us will be experiencing the presence of God. Because this is much more important than having this church building. That in your life you will have this experience.
God be with you.
That God is with you. And you would see how true your faith is. May the Lord bless us. May we give all the glory to God. Let's pray. 天父上帝，我们高处这边真心感谢你。天父上帝，你是在这个信息的上帝，你是这个全能的上帝。既然你有带我们到这个坎站上帝，我们相信。 你个计在继续引出阮一步一步，阮虽然会拄着真侪挑战、真侪问题，但是主阮要靠着你的力量来完成主你的工作，求你帮助阮伫遮发人活苦的，有通辛苦的，有法人安遮顺服你。阮感谢你，你予阮啊这个机会，通及地配合来做你的工作。阮呢，你祈祷，感恩是靠主耶稣基督的圣名。
Amen. Thank you, brother.